Good morning, church. There we go. There we go. Happy Sabbath. How are you this morning? Blessed? Good? Happy to be here? You sure? Praise God, because it's praise God for the Sabbath. There's no other place to be. That's right. There's no other better place to be on the Sabbath day. There's no other better place to be. I want to welcome everyone to the Cleburne First Seventh-day Adventist Church, and those who are watching online, welcome also to your church. And so we're glad that you're tuning with us online. If you're able to make it, we do invite you. There's plenty of room still here in the church. And so join us next Sabbath if you're able to come out. If you're not able to come out, we still want to worship together and welcome you online. But for those who are here, just turn to the person next to you and just say happy Sabbath. If you want to give them a handshake, a hug, a fist bump, whatever you would like, let them know that God loves you and we love you here at Cleburne First as well. There are a couple of announcements. I want to first invite Tina before our elder comes up to share some announcements. VBS is coming very soon, and so Tina has a couple of announcements and a little video to share.
I want to go ahead and show the video first.
Hey guys, Nash here in the Nash Cave. So this week we're doing something a little different. For the entire week, I'm going to be taking part in a special archaeology camp. And you guys get to see it all. So, here they are. The team, the fam, mi compadres.
Sadie is a major brain. Straight A's. We're talking A plus, 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 plus. Then there's Zach, laid back Zach. He sees himself as a deep thinker, but that's not why he's here. His mom made him come. We have to create a video presentation by the end of the week answering a major archaeological question. How does archaeology uncover the truth about Jesus?
To help us this week, we've been assigned a real archaeologist to advise us and help us with our project.
I've got a bunch of videos from my last trip to Israel. Here you're gonna see someone on camera. His name is Barney. Super awesome guy. He was my driver and he was a huge help while I was there. Anyway,
you'll see. Let's just say it gets interesting.
That look fun. Vacation Bible School is coming up next week. We have one more week to prepare, but next week is Vacation Bible School, and every night there's a video presentation by this young man. His name is Nash, and he shows you all kinds of real archaeological digs over in Israel and shows you some of the things that they've been doing. Proof that the Bible is real and we can find Jesus there in history and as well as in the Bible now. So I want to invite all of you to come, all of you kids, ages 4 to 11. Also, we have 12 to 16. So we have a teenage group, a little older venue, a little older stuff, but you still have crafts and games, something to do, something fun. So I hope everyone will come. There is a registration link. It's ClebourneFirstVBS.com. So go on the website and register. If you can't, give us a call at the office. She can help you out, or just show up here and we can register you when you get here. So next week, you have one more week, Monday the 19th, 6 o'clock, runs from 6 to 8:30. Hope to see you there.
Morning, church. The teacher from the chapel class has asked all the Sabbath school members of that class to stay by after the church service today for just a few minutes. They have something they need to discuss with the class. Today's offering is for the world budget. A lot of things that the world budget covers, and there's always something somewhere that they need. Tomorrow there will be a work bee for CECS, and starting next week we'll have our first general potluck. Don't forget, if you come, bring something enough for your family and a few more. Church business meeting has been moved to July the 27th. We hope to see you all there.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. So our 2x2 ministries have been doing an excellent job going out and knocking on doors. They have done an amazing job, so praise God for them. But I want them to meet one more time this afternoon at the FLC. Right after service, we're going to have a season of prayer about the people we've come in contact with. And we're also going to fill out a small sheet of the people that you've had and you've interacted with, so we know who to pray over. So if you're in a 2x2 ministries and you were handing out the Bible studies and you're making friends out in our community, please meet with me in FLC right after service for about 15 minutes, all right? All right, God bless you all and happy Sabbath.
I'm back again. It's time for our song service this morning. If you have a hymnal, it's the number 534. Otherwise, the words will be on the screen. Sing with me. Will Your Anchor Hold?
Keeps the soul steadfast.
on page 537, saying, "He leadeth me." Children's story. So if all the children will gather their basket from the back, come on down the aisles and gather the offering that goes to our church school, and then come on down here to the front. We have a story. Miss Sharon here has us waiting for you. I have a story. And while the kids will collect their offering, we are going to sing a song that's number 529, Under His Wings.
Thank you. Good morning, boy and girls. Wow, you're lucky today, huh? And y'all look so intelligent, because I'm going to ask some questions and I need your help, okay? Who knows what a label is? A label. What's a label? Okay, so when you buy something, it has a label on it so that you know what's inside, right? Okay, that makes sense. So what's inside here? Potato chips, that's right. That's right, it's all crunchy. And what's inside here? Soup, tender bits. See? Tender bits in there. We can tell by the label, right? Okay. And the sound, that's right. No, the soup doesn't make a sound. What's in here? Toothpaste. What kind of toothpaste? Mint toothpaste? It says Colgate. There's a tube of toothpaste in there. Oh, I bet you don't know what this is. Snickers. How can you tell it's a Snickers? There's a C on it. Oh, it says on the other side. But you know what? You know what's in there, right? All right, here's a tricky one. Green beans. Okay, because it has a label, right? Okay, so I need one person. Let's see. You, come. Let's look inside here, okay? Can you open that for me? What's inside there?
That's not green.
Well, what is it?
It's grass.
Well, it's green.
But it's not beans.
But the label says it is.
The label's wrong.
The label's wrong. Oh, put that aside. That's mislabeled. Okay, this is toothpaste. Why don't you open that up and see what's in there? Toothpaste. It's not toothpaste. The label says it's toothpaste. The label's wrong. Pliers? Whoa, that's really wrong, isn't it? Somebody got that wrong. Okay, well, the potato chips have to be right, right?
They better be right.
They better be right. Let's open that up. Oh, yummy potato chips.
Leaves.
What? But they're crunchy.
They're not yummy, though.
They're not yummy? We'll try one. Let's see.
No.
No? So, those aren't potato chips? This one's... Oh, my goodness here. Yeah. All right. Tender bits. That's veggie.
Tender bits.
It's probably not, but it says it...
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, what is it?
Dirt.
Oh. Oh. Okay. Oh. All right. Well, you can never go wrong with the Snickers, right?
It's something.
Oh.
It's a carrot.
Oh.
Not a carrot.
It's a healthy Snickers.
It's a carrot.
Oh. So, what happened? Thank you. You
can see.
All the labels were wrong. How can that be? Put stuff in it? Oh no. So if we all have labels on us that we're Christian, what is inside of us? A heart? What kind of heart? A red heart, okay? But is it a heart for good things or is it a heart for evil? Good things, that's right. So as a Christian, will I look like this? Or will I look like this and happy? Will I say, good morning, boys and girls? Or will I say, what are y'all doing up here? Huh?
You'll say, good morning,
and boy. So there's, if we have the label of a Christian, because we do, don't we? We're all children of God. So they call us Christians, right? So if we have that label, what's inside, though? Is it really Christian things inside, or is it something fake? No, but inside us, we want to be the real thing inside, don't we? Yes, we want to be kind and loving and not lie or cheat or steal, right? We want to be good inside, just like the label says, right? All right, let's remember that you are a Christian. Make sure that what's inside is what the label says, okay? All right, y'all can tiptoe back to your seats. And these are real. Just get one and don't eat it till your mommy says, okay? All right.
Amen. Thank you so much for that story, for that lesson. Amen. Amen. As we come to the garden of prayer, as we seek God in prayer, I wanted to just read from a Bible verse here from 1 Corinthians 10:13. Maybe we know it by memory. 1 Corinthians 10:13 is a promise. It's one of my favorite promises because there we go. Okay. You couldn't hear me before? Oh, now you can't hear me? 1 Corinthians 10:13 is a wonderful promise because it reminds us that God is faithful, that he will not allow to give us more than what we can handle. Amen. That's such a blessing. There, no temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with a temptation, he will also make a way of escape. And that way of escape is Jesus Christ. That is the only way of escape. And so if the trial is more than what you can bear, let's pay attention, church. If the trial is more than you can bear, then God is not faithful. But is God ever unfaithful? No. God is always faithful. That means that we did not turn to Christ. If the trial fits me, if the trial is on me, then God tailored or allowed that trial to be measured up to what I can take if I put my faith in him. I want to just share this quote from Our High Calling here, page 323. Our Heavenly Father measures and weighs every trial before he permits it to come upon the believer. Amen. That means that maybe for you, you can handle more than I can, or vice versa. It's not one trial fits everyone. No. God knows each of our hearts and personalities. He considers the circumstances and the strength of the one who is to stand under the proving and test of God, and he never permits the temptations to be greater than the capacity of resistance. Never. If the soul is overborne, the person overpowered, this can never be charged to God. Whose fault is it? It's not God's fault who gave us too much. It's our fault that we didn't turn to him to the way of escape. But the one tempted was not diligent and prayerful and did not appropriate by faith the provisions God had abundantly in store for him. Christ never failed a believer in his hour of combat. Amen. What a beautiful promise, friends. The believer must claim the promise and meet the foe in what? In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. So as we come to the garden of prayer, as we seek God in prayer, I don't know what you may be struggling with. I don't know what your burden is. I know what my burden is, what our family burdens is. God knows what it is, and God knows what yours is. And so let's come to him in prayer, claiming this promise, and we And the believer must claim the promise and meet the foe in the name of the Lord, friends. And what a beautiful, beautiful promise there that Christ never failed a believer in our hour of combat. So if you're able to kneel, I invite you to kneel. If you cannot, just bow your heads as we spend time in prayer and claiming these beautiful promises that we are never alone and God is always with us. Let's come now to the garden of prayer.
Lord, our Maker and our God, we are grateful for this Sabbath day to come apart on this beautiful day to come and worship you. Lord, we're grateful for so many blessings that you give us, for this country that we can freely worship you in. Lord, just as the statement that was read says, give us the strength to meet each one of our temptations as we go forward with you. Lord, we think of those that cannot be with us today, the folks that are ill, the folks that are on our prayer list. Lord, please watch over and protect all. We think of the 2x2 ministry, and Lord, we hope to see many of them in a couple of weeks when we have our meetings here. Lord, be with your speaker today. Anoint his lips and bring us words from on high. Thank you, Lord, for so many things. This we ask in Christ's name. Amen. scripture reading this morning is found in Jeremiah 6:16. Thus says the Lord, stand in the ways and see, and ask for the old paths where the good way is, and walk in it. Then you will find rest in your souls. But they said, we will not walk in it. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Amen. Thank you very much. Happy Sabbath, church. Good morning once again. Just, I know that it was already mentioned, just wanted to reiterate, and that is that after church, those that are members of the Sabbath school class in the chapel, if you can just meet in the chapel for a short little quick announcement request right after church, those who belong to the chapel class. And so I'm looking forward to this vacation Bible school. And also, because it isn't a Bible school only for the kids, but it's a family vacation Bible school for everyone. Because while the kiddos are enjoying and learning about Jesus in the Family Life Center, at the same time in the sanctuary, we will be having meetings. We will be learning about God and also excavating through the Bible. Excavating through the Bible. So I invite you to come, bring your friends, bring your neighbors, bring anyone you want, bring your kids. They go off to vacation Bible school and we stay and opening the Word of God. Amen? Amen. Let's have a word of prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, I thank you so much for your goodness. I thank you for your blessings. And now open our hearts, remove any evil influence, Lord. And thank you because you hear my prayers. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Have you ever heard the expression, that's old school? Have you used that expression before? Are you old school? You know, that expression is sometimes used when they're talking about something obviously that's old and antique or antiquated or been replaced with something better or modern. And here's just a couple examples of things that are old school. Like old car, no, I'm sorry, old phones. Let's go to phones first. The first wireless cellular phone. It had the nickname of the brick because it was about the size of a brick. But we were excited because now we didn't have to, you know, connect to the wall. Or this phone, the rotary phone. You know where this phone is at? It's here in the church. I guess we're still old school. It's in the foyer, in the closet there. Somebody called their church office, it rings. And so it was interesting watching my kids years ago figure out how to make a call on this phone. And for those who remember these phones and you had these phones, maybe in your kitchen, you probably, and it was a blessing because I remember my grandparents and my parents having a long cord. So that way you can walk to the stove and you're doing there and you walk over to the sink and the kids are trying not to get in the way of the cord, but you're still on the phone. You're still on the phone. What about these Nokia phones? I remember those were very popular for a long time, but still considered old school. But now with all the technology that we have, you know, these smartphones that are basically a computer in your hand, so much can be done with these devices that we cannot live without. You know, not only can you talk on the phone, but now you can talk on your watch. You can actually receive phone calls. That's old school. What about old cars? This is a 1929 Model A car. And this belongs to Bob and Margie Bullock. And I believe, if I see correct, that looks like that's Vicky in the back seat there. Talk about old school. Or how about this old car? I wouldn't mind having this old school car. 1965 Mustang. All right? Subaru Brat. And now, Subarus are very good cars. We used to have a Subaru. My parents had Subarus. They're very long-lasting cars. I don't know why it's called a Brat. Maybe because it didn't want to be a car or a truck. But it's an old-school car. What about the Volkswagen Bug? This was the vehicle, well, not this particular one, but Volkswagen Bug was the vehicle that I first learned how to drive. My grandfather was the one that taught most of his grandkids how to drive because he wanted chauffeurs. And so it was interesting and fun learning how to drive standard and with no power steering. And so very, very fond memories. What about old school entertainment with movies? How many remember going to the video place and renting VHS or DVDs? And if they didn't have enough copies, they'll tell you, well, it's coming in next week. Oh, okay, I'll come back next week. Right, but now we can rent a movie with our smart devices. If you have a particular app, whether it's Netflix, whether it's Prime, whether it's Hulu or any other companies out there, or even these type of entertainment with the radio, with cassette players or Walkmans, where you had to, you know, turn over the cassette to listen to the music on the other side of the cassette. It was interesting because even with these radios, how many here would have it on a particular station, and you had the cassette there ready to record it because you wanted a copy for yourself, but you didn't want to go buy it. And as soon as the radio played that song, you would hit the record, and then wait, and then you would stop it. But then you would have the announcer, you know, talking during the intro of the song, and you're like, oh no, I wish he would be quiet. This is all old school stuff. Old school. What about computers? For those gamers, any gamers recognize any of these games systems? Yes, all right, Justin. So, you know, the Atari. I remember having the Atari, the Game Boy. That was a very exciting time when I first got Game Boy. Even one of the first computers, you know, you had to use a floppy disk, and I should have brought one. I have one. They're old school things. Now, for this next slide, it's going to have an audio. I want you to raise your hand if you know exactly what this sound is. How many young people know what that is? Or you're wondering, what on earth is that? If you wanted to get on the internet, you had to dial up and it would make that noise. And once you were on the internet, your phone line was busy. Your phone line was busy, and if mother tried to call you, or somebody, or a friend tried to call you, and they would just get the busy signal, and they would know, oh, they must be on the internet. And so, but now what a blessing. We've come a long ways, friends. I consider myself young, and I remember doing this. You know what else is old school? Pathfinders is old school. Pathfinders began around the mid-1940s. That's pretty old school. Even Pathfinder's honors are old school. Identifying flowers, identifying birds, how to make a fire. Those are old school honors. Those are old school activities. I've yet to see honors such as video games, most liked on social media honors. I haven't seen that. Or maybe honors on how to create a YouTube channel. All we see, you know, old school honors. And so there are scripture reading from Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16. Now that we're loosened up a little bit, let's open our Bibles. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16. Thus says the Lord, stand in the way and see and ask for the old paths, where the good way is, and walk in it. Then you will find rest in your soul. How will we find rest in our soul, friends? By walking in what kind of paths? Old paths. You see, but this world doesn't like old things. The world wants new and improved, the latest and the greatest. And now, don't get me wrong, there are some things that I prefer modern, absolutely. There are, I like the modern invention and technology of going to the bathroom. Going camping and digging a hole, it's not, that's an old school that I'll leave behind. There are many modern technologies that I am very grateful and happy for happy to be part of, but some things I do like to be old school. As a church, should we hold on to old school stuff only because we've always done it or because they're biblical? Right? Well, because they're biblical. Because we live in a time where following Jesus biblically, many people claim to follow Jesus and they may have good intentions, but following Jesus biblically in some areas, in some places, is considered to be old school. Old school. It's old school to go to church. It's old school to go to church. It's old school to date someone of your same faith. No, that's old school. This reminds me of someone in the Bible who lived in the secular times, but still at a very young age, stood for what was right, even though it was old school. And so now we're going to Second Chronicles. This is where we're going to spend all of our time. Second Chronicles chapter 33. Second Chronicles chapter 33. There are many Bible characters, Bible persons, both male and female, that followed the Lord, that did what was right. I chose this particular young man for a reason. 2 Chronicles chapter 33. Now in 2 Chronicles chapter 33, we have the story of King Manasseh and King Amon. King Manasseh was the worst king, the worst of the worst king in Israel. He was even worse than the pagan kings. All right, so follow me there in 2 Chronicles chapter 33, verse 2. 2 Chronicles 33, verse 2, it says, "But he," talking about Manasseh, "did evil in the sight of the Lord, according to the abomination of the nation whom the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel." Verse 3, "For he rebuilt the high places which Hezekiah his father had broken down. He raised up altars for the Baals and made wooden images, and he worshipped all the host of heaven and served them." Jump to verse 6. "He also caused his sons to pass through the fire in the valley of the son of Hinnom. He practiced soothsaying, used witchcraft and sorcery, and consulted mediums and spiritists. He did much evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger." So was he following God's will? Not even an ounce. Look at verse 9. Verse 9. "So Manasseh seduced Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to do more evil than the nations whom the Lord had destroyed before the children of Israel." He was so bad that he was even worse than the pagan kings. To sacrifice your own kids to Baal. Sacrifice your own children to Baal. And create all these idols and worship and contacting mediums and getting involved with witchcraft. The worst of the worst king. So Manasseh dies. Now, praise the Lord. You may think, well, he's doomed to hell. But when you read the rest of the chapter, Manasseh repents and turns to God. That's a whole different sermon of the grace of God. But Manasseh passed away and his son becomes king. And look at there in verse 21. You see, Manasseh, he didn't follow God's ways. Like, no, that's old school. He wanted to keep up with what everyone else is doing, their gods, their philosophies, and so does his son Amon. Look at verse 21, The Bible says Amon was 22 years old when he became king, and he reigned 2 years in Jerusalem, but he did evil in the sight of the Lord, as his father Manasseh had done. For Amon sacrificed to all the carved images which his father Manasseh had made and served them, and he did not humble himself before the Lord as his father Manasseh had humbled himself, but Amon trespassed more and more. Verse 24, then his servants conspired against him and killed him, where? In his own house. So this is just a little context. Here we see Manasseh, the worst king. And his son, well, he sees dad doing this, and so when he become king, he follows dad's example. And also is a bad king. But they kill him in his own home. And after Amon is murdered, they made Amon's son king, and that's who I want to talk about, who is Josiah. Josiah becomes king at 8 years old. Anybody here 8 years old? Nobody? Almost eight? Oh, okay. Somebody's eight. Imagine being in charge of a whole nation at 8 years old. Look at 2 Chronicles chapter 34, verse 1. Josiah was 8 years old when he became king, and he reigned 31 years in Jerusalem. Verse 2, and he did what was right in the sight of God and walked in the ways of his father David. He did not turn aside to the right hand or to the left hand. In whose ways did Josiah walk? In his father Amon's way? In his grandfather's way? No. In old school David's way. In old school David's way. We'll get to the quote in a little bit. Look at verse 3 and verse 4. For in the eighth year of his reign, so that makes him what? 16. While he was still young, he began to seek the God of his father David, and in the 12th year, what, 20 maybe? He began to purge Judah and Jerusalem of the high places and wooden images, the carved images, and the molded images. Verse 4, they broke down the altars of the Baals in the presence of the incense altars which were above them. He cut down, and the wooden images, the carved images, and the molded images, he broke into pieces and made them dust. And made dust of them and scattered it over the graves of those who had sacrificed to them. Who were some of those that had sacrificed to them? His dad and his grandfather. And so look at here from Patriarchs and Prophets, page 384, talking about young Josiah. With the accession of Josiah to the throne, where he was to rule for 31 years for the new king, though only 8 years old, feared God, and from the very beginning he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Born of a wicked king, beset with temptation to follow in his father's steps, Josiah nevertheless was true to the God of Israel. Amen. He chose to do right instead of descending to the low level of sin and degradation to which his father and his grandfather had fallen. Wow. So young people, here is a perfect example of doing right. Even if it's considered old school. Even if the modern thing is, well, you got to do how your daddy did and we seem to be doing great and your grandfather was the same way. No, I'm going to follow the ways of David. Old school David. And so this morning, there are things that we as a church need to return, or maybe I should say not let slip away. They haven't completely gone. But let's not let them slip away of these things that we might consider them to be old school. old school. So what are some Adventist old school things? Well, there are many, but I'm only going to go over four of them. And one of them is Christian appearance. Christian appearance. When it comes to appearance, we are losing our identity. We, I mean, as the Seventh-day Adventist. We are losing. It's not lost, but it's slipping from our fingers as our identity as Seventh-day Adventists. There was a time when Seventh-day Adventists didn't wear jewelry. Now, before I continue, there are Adventists and Christians maybe still wearing jewelry, and some maybe in this church right now. This is still the place for you to be. Amen. Don't take this personal. This is not an offense toward you as a person. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. So church, don't look around and see, oh, look, no. This is not, that's not what this is for. The church is still the best place to be, no matter what a person's condition is. There are worse things than jewelry, by the way, which most of us are guilty. But here, we don't promote or the wear of jewelry. This is a place, of course, for everyone, but God tells us, through his word, and I invite you to write these texts down. We're not going to go into every text today, but I invite you to write these texts down. Genesis chapter 35, verse 1 through 4. Here, Jacob is going to Bethel, and he's taking his family, and they're going to be with God. And God is saying, what am I going to do with you? You got to get rid of these idols. You got to get rid of these adornments, your family, these jewelries. You got to get rid of it. And so they bury it on their way to meet God and to be with God in Bethel. We are on our way to a promised land, friends. We need to get rid of things that hinder of coming to God. Exodus 33 verse 5. When you read that, they're at the mountain with God, and God is so frustrated. He's like, what am I going to do with you stiff-necked people who refuse to let this thing go from Egypt? I know you brought them from Egypt and you've been trained for over 400 years, but let it go. You don't need that. You don't need to add value to yourself. God, friends, God values us so much that we don't need to add things on us to add value. Isaiah chapter 3, read the whole chapter, the complete chapter of Isaiah chapter 3. And Isaiah warns Israel, warns the people, that God will strike them because they want to hold on to their pendants, to their bracelets, to their charms, to their rings. And it names specifically all of these items. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 9 and 10, Paul tells us that our dress should be modest and not adorned with gold or pearls. Is this an old school thing, or is this a biblical thing? Okay, here from Counsels for the Church, that's for all of us. Self-denial in dress is a part of our Christian duty. You see, because as Christians, we deny ourselves in everything. And that would include also dress. To dress plainly, abstaining from display of jewelry and ornaments of every kind, is in keeping with our faith. As ambassadors of Christ, friends, we don't want the attention to come on us and say, look at me. No. We want to point to Jesus. When they look at us, we want them to see Jesus. We don't want them to see the latest fashion, the latest adornments, whatever it may be. Now, I must say, that does not mean. And again, I encourage you to read, we'll get to that point in a little bit, but that does not mean that Christians should dress, you know, like we look like we're needy and we need a handout. We are ambassadors of Christ, friends. We represent God Almighty. We should look the best that we can, the sharpest that we can, but being careful not drawing the line that we want to grab the attention for us. We need to represent Christ in everything that we do, in everything that we wear. So is that maybe old school? Maybe, but we see it both in Scripture and we see it both in God's messenger. In God's messenger. Something else that maybe we need to hold on to that may be considered old school, and that's the writings of Ellen G. White. Some believe that her writings are just old school, not relevant. We have much better information today. Or some only believe half of what she writes. Friends, when we study the Bible, do we only believe half the Bible or the entire Bible? The entire Bible, both new and old. We don't take anything out. We don't take a piece out because it's inconvenient. No, we believe the whole Bible. So we can't accept only the book Counsels on Diet and ignore Christian service. If we, you know, if we're going to take care of our bodies, which is great, we should. But then also observe and also do what she talks about, Christian service. We can't accept only the book Country Living and ignore on what she says in the book of Evangelism and talking about living in the cities and providing salvation to the people in the cities. Yes, there is a time and she does promote country living, but then in Evangelism she says, hey, where are the people? Are they in the country or are they in the city? They're in the city. Go to the city. There's a balance that she gives. We can't just take one piece and ignore the rest of it. Just how when we study Scripture, we study it completely. Ellen White points us to God in a balanced way, and we need to take all of it. All of it. Now, don't answer out loud, but just answer in your head. To yourself, what was the last book in the Bible or maybe passage of Scripture that you read? Can you picture that in your mind? I can remember already which one it is. Now, at the same time, what was the last book or passage from the Spirit of Prophecy that you read? If it's been a while that you've read it, I encourage you, I invite you to read it. If you don't want to go buy some here, I mean, go buy one at the ABC. We have a beautiful stock library right here in the church with plenty of material from child guidance, Christian service, evangelism, testimony to the church. We are blessed, friends. We are so blessed. And so when you read, whenever I encourage and we're studying the Bible about Ellen White, I make a simple invitation and appeal. If she doesn't point you toward the Bible, then get rid of it. Throw her away. But you need to read it with an open mind and an open heart, because every time we read her writing, we read what her counsels, her main objective is to point us to Scripture, to point us to repentance, to point us to a better walk with God. To a better walk with God. On the contrary, she doesn't even point us to herself. She's always pointing toward Jesus. Look toward the cross. Look toward the cross. She even says, if people would have studied their Bibles, you wouldn't need me. And so we need to hold on. If this old school, I believe it's biblical. God has given us, and there, 1 Thessalonians 5:20, do not despise prophecies. No, don't despise it. The rest of the verse continues saying, but check everything, test everything. In the same way, let's take the writings of Ellen White and test them to see. And when you see and test them, you'll find out that it is sweet and it is a blessing. So what else may be considered old school? Well, you may be thinking, the Sabbath? What do you mean, Pastor Charles? Well, we are here. Yes, we are here. But I'm talking about Sabbath observance. Sabbath observance. We know all the text of Exodus 20, of how in Genesis the Sabbath began there. I mean, we can cite all the text on how in the book of Acts, all the places where the apostles worshiped on the seventh day, and Paul worshiped as his custom was, and how in Isaiah we're going to continue worshiping even in the new earth, Sabbath after Sabbath. We know all these texts and we keep the Sabbath. But let's not forget, Sabbath isn't just what we do here right now for 2 hours. Remember, the commandment says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. It's the day. It's the entire day. It's not just the 2 hours. Friends, we are committing a big sin, a sin. Sin is sin. When we treat the Sabbath as any other day, as any other day. Let's not think that we're okay with God while we willfully trample on his holy hours. Even right now, these hours are holy hours. How? I don't know. How can I explain it? I can't. All I know is that God says, this is holy time. Just how he told Moses, take off your feet, take off your sandals, because this is holy ground. This is holy time that we're in right now. And we need to guard it and be careful of how, what we do on these holy hours. Is it old school? No. I invite you to read Nehemiah chapter 13, the whole chapter. Here Nehemiah is pleading with the people there at Jerusalem because they're waiting. They have their carts to sell and they want to do business. And he says, get that out of here. It's the Sabbath day. Don't do it right now. Okay, so they move just a little bit outside the gates and they're just there standing, waiting for the sundown to open up shop. Nehemiah gets more upset. He says, take these out of my sight. And he talks about the Sabbath observance and the guarding of the Sabbath hours, friends. Shopping, eating, playing video games, all this is breaking the Sabbath while we're doing it on the Sabbath hours. God tells us, I give you 6 days to do what? Whatever we want. Well, to work. And then after work, you can play video game, you can entertain yourself, you can eat out, you can whatever you need. I give you 6 days. Praise, you know, God could have said, I give you three and you give me three. But God doesn't go with three and three, does he? Or half and half? No. He said, I give you 6 days. Hello? God says, just give me one. Just give me one day. Is that old school or is that biblical? Just the last one that I want to just briefly cover, and there are so many. The last one talks about entertainment. Entertainment. There was a time when dancing wasn't an issue in the Adventist church. But now, you know, maybe it's considered old school. And people go dancing, and you even see it in Adventist weddings, dancing. Is that old school or just biblical? Well, here, from Christian temperance and Bible hygiene and recreation, is two books that I took this quote from. Recreation, here the pen of inspiration, God's messenger for us, tells us that recreation is needful to those who engage in physical labor and still more essential for those who work whose work is principally mental. You may not work physical, but you're in the office and your brain is thinking. And what does she say? Recreation is needful. And then notice, it is not essential to our salvation nor to the glory of God to keep the mind laboring constantly and excessively, even upon religious things. Are you catching that? She's saying recreation is necessary. And at the same time, we don't have to be 24 hours. It's not necessary 24 hours, you know, like a monk just repeating Psalm 23 over and over and nothing else. No, no, no. It is not necessary to our salvation nor for the glory of God to keep the mind laboring constant and excessively even upon religious things. Solomon tells us in Proverbs, there's a time for everything. There's a time for everything. Or Ecclesiastes, I'm sorry. There are amusements such as card playing, dancing, theater going, etc., which we cannot approve because heaven condones them. They open the door to great evils. By their exciting tendency, they produce in some minds a passion for gambling and what? Dissipation. You know, where she talks about card playing, she's referring to gambling. It's not that she has something against, you know, playing Uno cards. Unless you're gambling. And even that, gambling is another one. Friends, we should not be heading out to Oklahoma to get lucky. Amen, friends. Are these just old school things? Or are these biblical things? God is preparing us for salvation. For salvation. Adventist Home, page 517. In our days, dancing is associated with folly and midnight reveling. Health and morals are sacrificed to pleasure. By the frequenters of the ballroom, God is not an object of thought and reverence. Prayer and the song of praise would be felt to be out of place in their assemblies. A simple question. Ask yourself, can I bring Jesus with me? Can I honestly, wherever I'm going, if I'm going to go, and we've been, our family, we've been to weddings, and if you haven't been to a Mexican wedding, you, it can get pretty rowdy, and there has to come a time where we have to, you know what, congratulations, best of luck, we'll see you next time. We just have to leave. There has to come a time where we separate ourselves from that environment. And again, friends, we need to be balanced. You know, there are times where even in our house, we dance around with the kids and just they're being silly. But she's talking about the dancing that today is more of a sexual dance, holding somebody close. I'm not going to get too much into details, but this is not things that we can, in our minds, sincerely say, can I bring Jesus with me to the nightclub? Can I bring Jesus with me to this event? Can I dance with this person who's not my spouse and Jesus will be with me? Ask yourselves those questions. And if you're not sure, maybe if it's not a no-brainer, if you're not sure, then stay away from it. You're safe to stay away from it. Because, you know how John the Baptist got killed? Herod had his head chopped off, but why did he have his head chopped off? Because somebody danced nice in front of him, and he promised, whatever you want, I'll give you. And they asked for John the Baptist's head. Friends, the Adventist life is not boring. I would expect somebody to agree, but that's fine. If it's old school, it's old school. The Adventist lifestyle, it is not boring. I chose Josiah to look here at the story of Josiah because the bad influence he had didn't come from pagans. The bad influence of Josiah came from where? From within. His own dad, his own grandparents were bad influences. But yet Josiah says, I ain't going to follow their ways. I know what's right. I know what the prophets say. I know what the word says. I'm going to do what's right. We may be tempted even from within our own groups, from our own schools, from our own institutions, from our own clan, whatever we want to call ourselves. To do things, to go places. But I want to invite you, like Josiah, to do what's right, to follow the old path. Even if it's considered being old school, well, I'm old school then. Were we wrong? Were we wrong when these principles were looked at and we began to promote these principles? Or have we drifted? Friends, and these are just a few. There's so many other things that we can share, but we cannot rely. We cannot rely on culture to determine what I do. Don't miss what I just said. I cannot rely on my culture to determine what I do. You know, in my culture, we visit the dead, and we bring them food, and we have a big party for the dead. But what does the Bible say? The dead don't know anything. Don't visit them. Don't talk to them. So I can't follow my culture to decide what I want to do. We must rely on God's word and God's messenger. Biblical culture, don't miss this part. Biblical culture will always go against the current culture. Always. Always. That's why we are peculiar people, set aside people, holy people. That's why Romans chapter 12, verse 2, Paul reminds us, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And perfect will of God. In your meditation, as we close, and your meditation is taken from Great Controversy, page 464. Before the final visitation of God's judgment upon the earth, what does that mean? Before what? The second coming, right? Before the final visitation of God's judgment upon this earth, there will be among the people of the Lord such a revival of what type of godliness? What does that mean? Old school? Old school. As has not been witnessed since apostolic times. Friends, we need to continue, not let go of these biblical principles. Now, if it's not biblical, yes, let it go. If it's not biblical. But if it's biblical, and even if it goes against current culture, friends, let's do like Martin Luther, here I stand and I can't do nothing else. So help me God. And God will help us. And if I'm old school because I follow the Bible, then I'm old school. And I want to appeal to you, friends, to be biblical. And if that means that we're old school together, well, let's be old school. Church, God knows in my heart, and I'm telling you the truth, that I love you with all my heart. And I want all of us to enter into the gates of heaven. Every single one of us, friends. Every single one of us. Are there things in my heart that God is still working? Absolutely, there are. Absolutely. And I'm sure there are things in your heart, and that's between me and God, and that's between you and the Lord. It is not my work to do the work of the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit to do His work. It is my job to render my will to His will. Render my will to His will. It is not my job to render your will to His will. I can't twist your arm to do His will. It is your job to render your will to His will. And so let's be careful. Let's not be pointing fingers. Let's not be looking. No. You worry about yourself, and that's it. I worry about myself. I worry about my home. I worry about my home. Let's worry about our own selves and follow the principles of God, and there are many other principles in His Word, and as we're learning about these principles, let's continue to follow His will. As when He comes, we will return to a primitive godliness, to an old school, following God's word, friends. Following God's word. Are you glad you came to church today? Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, God, I just thank you so much because you remind us. You remind us to follow these old paths. You remind us to be faithful to you. And thank you for the example of even a young person, young Josiah, at a young age, as a teenager, and even as a young adult, he didn't turn to the right or to the left, but was faithful to you. in spite of his bad influence in the family. Lord, help us to look to you, only to you, and not to others, to be faithful to you. And if it's not current or not popular, Lord, we know we're not looking for popularity. We're just looking to be faithful to you. And so help us to share that love with others, just how your son did, in a loving way. And may your Holy Spirit convict every heart, every soul. And may we continue to walk with you and be faithful unto the end, because he who endures shall be saved. And so, Lord, help us, give us the strength to endure. And thank you again for that promise in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Be with your church. Be with us on this, your holy day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 I want you to stand. Would you please stand as we sing our closing hymn? I'm trying to see here. 304. 304.
Lord, we are grateful for old school, the biblical old school. Lord, help us to continue to follow you through the biblical way. Be with us now as we leave this place. Give us all travel mercies back to our respective homes. And bring us back for the midweek service on Wednesday evening. This we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
be seated.